Hello. Good evening. Welcome, everybody. On behalf of the trustees and board of Yisrael, my name is Michelle Sint, and I have the pleasure to welcome you all here this evening. I'm very excited about this, which I'm sure this debate is going to be a very fascinating and will present very diverse views. So I'm sure we all look forward to that. So let me just present the speakers. Rabbi Kimche, who is against the motion, is of course well known to all of us. He's been a Rav and senior lecturer for over 30 years. He's also completed his PhD from London University and gives regular shiurim on a wide range of topics, specializing in Jewish philosophy and halakha. For the motion, over here we have Ambassador David Kornbluth and his wife Etty. He is an international public lawyer qualified in Israel and England. He was born in London, educated at Yeshiva Keren B'Yavna and Queen's College, Cambridge. After Aliyah, he became an Israeli diplomat, negotiating at the highest level with Arab states, in particular with Syria and Egypt. He was Israel's ambassador to UNESCO and currently is a teaching fellow at the Hebrew University, Jerusalem, specializing in energy law. He works as a lawyer in that field. And in the middle, we have Tim Marshall, that we are delighted has come, well, from England, but all the way from Australia. How many hours ago?
12.
He is a British journalist, author, and broadcaster, known for his analysis of developments in foreign news and international diplomacy. He is a guest commentator on world events for the BBC, Sky News, and a guest presenter on LBC. So just so that you know, this debate is taking place after, well, a little bit of a gap, I suppose, of a few years. We had our last one in 1995. You never know, we can get another one together a bit earlier, depending on how we conduct it this evening, how it goes. And this was a debate on land for peace. And it took place in July 1995 between Rabbi Kimche and the late Chief Rabbi, Lord Jacobowitz. So we're especially delighted to have in the audience a notable guest, Sir Tom and Anne Phillips, KCMG, Commandant of the Royal College of Defence Studies. In his former career as a British diplomat in the FCO, Sir Tom's posting included serving as ambassador to Israel and subsequently serving as ambassador to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. We have very special thanks to Brian Berenblatt for bringing everybody together and really for making this happen. So as he said, and I'm going to quote him now, "We hope it will be a memorable evening for its generation of light rather than its production of heat." Thank you very much.
Welcome and the introduction. Thank you very much for coming along. I was very struck by the title of this talk and this debate, because it's clearly one that is required, and it's certainly attracted a lot of attention. And we've got two fascinating speakers who come at this both from extraordinarily learned backgrounds. Ambassador David Kornbluth has got more letters after his name than there are in both the Hebrew and English languages, I think, and has also negotiated borders, which is what we're coming to. Rabbi Kimche comes at this with a lot of learning as well, and although he's not speaking for the shul, and he's not speaking necessarily from on a religious basis, he does bring to the table 30 years of Torah learning, and we know what that does when it hones your mind. So I'm sure each is aware of the other's talents, which we're about to see. The format, 15 minutes each to set out the stall, 5 minutes each to then reply, and then we'd like to hear your questions to them. Now, what, there's about 100 of us?
More than 100.
Oh! All right, there's 200. Either way, we all know, if there have been 100 of us, that there's three people, sometimes in an audience, that don't ask questions but make very, 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 sorry, I'm jet-lagged, statements. And they don't ask questions. They make very, very long statements. And what the three people here don't know is that the other 97 of us are going, oh, God, how do I pray? Oh, Hashem. But that's not going to happen tonight, because those three people couldn't make it. They didn't get tickets. So we're going to get questions designed to bring some light to the subject, because we have two guiding lights here. Briefly set out the stall of where we are now. It all started a long time ago. Abraham. The Chaldees in Ur. I only bring that up because it allows me to make the one joke I'll make before I shut up. I was a television journalist for a very long time, and we always sign off, you know, to Marshall Sky News Berlin, to Marshall Sky News Damascus, or whatever. And I had this ambition. I used to go to Iraq a lot, I went to Baghdad a lot, but I had a real ambition. And it was always reminded whenever I drove past Ur, because I knew the ziggurat, and I never got time to stop, because my ambition was to go on television, make a report and say, Tim Marshall, Sky News, Never got there. Right, that's the joke out of the way. I'll fast forward from Abraham, let's say to 100 years ago, the Balfour Declaration. Let's forward again to 1937, the Peel Commission. Then let's go to 47, 48. You know this, but then let's go to 67, 73, 82. Let's go to the Wye Accords, Oslo. We'll go through the prime ministers. And every single time, this question has come up. And here it is again. And I think that tells us that it's time for some fresh original thinking, some new approaches, that even if you're a two-state solution kind of guy, we need some fresh thinking and some new approaches on that approach to the future. Or if we take a different view, we need now to explore new ideas about an alternative view. And I think that's what tonight is all about. And I'd like to ask Rabbi Kimche if he could come up first for 15 minutes. No longer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Tim. We probably won't solve the Middle East conflict this evening. But, with a bit of luck, we will try and present some of the issues on which the greatest analysts, political analysts, are divided. World Jewry is divided. My guess is everyone in this room, we are divided on this subject. And indeed, the Knesset is divided whether or not to promote this solution of creating a Palestinian state somewhere in Yehuda and Shomron. And my position this evening, and I'm going to sharpen the position a little bit because it's a debate, and to make debates exciting, you have a sharpish position. My position is that the suggestion of a two-state solution is insanity. That's my position. It's insane, it's suicidal, and it's a complete misunderstanding of who the enemy is and what a possible solution could possibly look like. Now, I use the word insane maybe in a certain type of sense. There's a famous quotation from Einstein. Albert Einstein said, the definition of insanity is to try and experiment, the same experiment again and again and again, hoping for a different outcome. That's insanity. That's what Einstein the scientist suggested. And I'm going to try and show you where we are in terms of applying that in the current situation. I'd like to start off with a disclaimer following the remark made by Tim, that indeed I'm not speaking this evening in my role as a rabbi. In other words, I'm not using rabbinic authority. Nothing that I say this evening is a psak halacha. Nothing that I say this morning is the Torah view on any subject. These are my views, my understanding of the situation, and should be seen in that light. I don't think that any sort of Torah dogmatic presentation of this question is useful, really, to anybody. There are definitely our sources of different sorts indicating different ideas. Any like we had with Rabbi Jacobowitz, the debate was more of a rabbinic debate where he brought his sources, I brought my sources. We're not doing that this evening. We're going to look at the subject for what it is directly. I'd like to say that I believe that both my sparring partner, David, who's been a good friend of mine for many years and will continue to be a good friend of mine even after this evening, that is my hope, that this evening will take place in the context of mutual derherets and understanding, that there are in fact two different schools of thought here throughout the Jewish world and indeed throughout the political world. But our common starting point is a love for Israel and a love for the Jewish people, and a desire to see Israel safe, secure, and prosper. And that is our joint starting point. We both agree that what is paramount is to provide for the Jewish people the best possible solution in their own homeland, and promote the ability of all of us, our children and grandchildren, to live peacefully in the land of Israel. That is our starting point. We know that currently there is great conflict, there are threats, there are great difficulties. Our end game is, please God, to have some utopian solution where we are living, Vishavtem al ha'oretz lavetach, that we will be living in Israel without any conflict, without any opposition, and we'll be able to prosper as Am Yisrael in the fullest sense possible. That's the end goal. And the question is how to get from point A to point Z. How do we get there? And there is a suggestion that in order to get there, we need to be party to creating a Palestinian state somewhere in the Yehuda and Shomron area. And what I'd like to present to you are what are the very, very serious problems which make that solution insane and completely unworkable. The first thing I want to speak about is Yehuda and Shomron. First of all, we'll have to be careful with language. In this debate, like in all debates, there's an attempt sometimes to sanitize the whole issue by using different language. So instead of saying Yehuda and Shomron, people will say the territories or the West Bank. And the minute you say that, you've lost, actually, one of the main issues here. That Yehuda and Shomron is the biblical heartland of the land of Israel. In fact, in one debate that I had many years ago after Oslo, when somebody was debating with me, not in the shul, about land for peace, I said, you know what, I'm all for land for peace. Let's start with Tel Aviv. Let's start giving them Tel Aviv in exchange for peace, and suddenly people think differently. Lots of people who suggest land for peace are because they're not familiar with Yehuda and Shomron as really the center of Jewish identity. And if we understand, as we do, that the Bible, that the Torah, is our mandate for Zionism, is our mandate for living in Israel, it all began and it all was centered in Yehuda and Shomron. The coastal plain was not the center of Jewish life. The center of Jewish life was Hebron, and Beit Lechem, and Shiloh, and, thank you, Shiloh, one of the material for Shiloh, right? The center of Jewish life were these towns. This is where Judaism was born and flourished throughout the biblical era and throughout the foundation of the Jewish people. Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov lived and were buried in Hebron. David HaMelech was crowned king of Israel in Hebron. And the first 7 years of David HaMelech's reign was in Hebron, and from Hebron he marched to Jerusalem to conquer Yerushalayim. But Hebron was the center. Beit Lechem, of course, is Rachel Imenu, and all the center of Jewish activity, Megillas Rus, and other descriptions in Beit Lechem. Shechem, of course, the kever of Yosef HaTzadik, and all the activity that took place in Shechem. All these events and all the history of the Jewish people, we are in fact called Jews, because at the end of the Tanakh we are referred to as Yehudim, and we're only called Yehudim because we lived in Yehuda and Shamar. Yehuda was our identity. This was not an incidental sort of backwaters of Jewish life. If we have any claims, and one of the main points I want to make this evening is, if we have any claim at all to live in Israel, it is primarily and firstly in Yehuda and Shamar. And the idea of somehow ceding Yehuda and Shamron is a denial of our connection to the heartland of Jewish history and Jewish identity. So this is one of the points that I wanted to make in terms of my argument. The second point is to have a look at our moderator today, Tim Marshall, has written a book called Prisoners of Geography, which I looked at and found very fascinating. The impact of geography, do I get a percentage? I get a commission, I was being offered a commission. Prisoners of Geography, showing the effect of geography on political decisions. That nations make political decisions and they factor in the geography of the land. And part of the geography is the concept of strategic depth of the land. That even if things go wrong, we have somewhere to go to, right? Whenever we have, whenever countries have conflicts with each other, they don't fight at the cutting edge, but they need to have certain geographical conditions have to hold in order for them to feel safe. Israel has got no strategic depth at all. Yehuda and Shomron provide the only strategic buffer to the east, and the only way in which we can make sure that the main areas of population are protected is if we control the Yehuda and Shomron, which are the mountains really overlooking the central part of Israel. Imagine Ben Gurion Airport. Imagine if there was even one group of Palestinians in Yehuda and Shomron who were able to fire a rocket, and one rocket landed near Ben Gurion Airport, all the international airlines would cancel their flights. And in one stroke, Israel is cut off. Now we know that sending rockets is something that happens instantly. We know that as soon as we have ceded any land at all to the Palestinians, the very first thing they do with it is to use it as launching pads for rockets against Israel. But we have kept the center of Israel safe by maintaining control of Yehuda and Shomron. And therefore, from a strategic point of view, it's insanity to even think about giving Yehuda and Shomron, making it into a Palestinian state. To imagine that we can give it to them and it'll be demilitarized is also whistling in the wind. South Lebanon was supposed to be demilitarized. When we came out of South Lebanon, how many rockets today? I don't know, over 100,000 rockets, they say, are in South Lebanon now. It has become a Hezbollah center. When we came out of Gush Katif, I remember Arik Sharon saying, when there was a disengagement, again, the word disengagement is also a bit of a sanitized word. It wasn't a disengagement, it was a... Disengagement sounds something like, you know, it's a social event. You go to an engagement, you go to a disengagement. Something which one does. One goes to disengagement. It was an expulsion of 8,000 people who had made their homes there with government permission for 25 years. And they built beautiful homes there. And suddenly they were expelled. They weren't disengaged. They were expelled from there. And Arik Sharon said, if one rocket comes from there, I'll take the whole thing back again. That's what he said. And what happened? We all know what happened. Gaza has become the Hamas stronghold in the area, and everything that we gave away to the Gush Katif in the Gaza disengagement was in fact used against us. We can see a clear pattern. And this is the argument against people who say, well, I know there are problems making a Palestinian state, but let's try it. Let's try it, it's worth trying. And the answer is, we've tried it. We've tried it in Gush Katif, we've tried it in Gaza, we've tried it in South Lebanon. We've tried it in lots of places, every single time we have withdrawn from a certain piece of land in order to cede it to the Palestinians. What has happened is, it has only encouraged them to more violence. Post-Oslo, what did we get post-Oslo? What did we get from all the concessions made at Oslo in the late 90s? We got the Intifada of the 2000 to 2003. Remember all the restaurants and the buses? And you couldn't go anywhere in Israel. And this was a clear result of giving away land and telling them, now this is your land, you can now, the Palestinian Authority is now allowed to self-rule in certain parts of Yehuda and Shomron. The more land that is given, the more this is seen, and this is already a psychological issue, I'm not going to go into it now, I've only got a few minutes left, but the psychology of our enemies are that as soon as you concede something, they view it as a sign of weakness. And if it's a sign of weakness, now is the time to attack. It isn't seen as a gesture of goodwill. It's seen as something which will only encourage greater aggression and greater force to be used against the Jewish people. There were attempts to give back land. One of the most frightening things, a minute to go, I'm going to finish off with one last fact which is relevant to this discussion, and that is, it was only 10 years ago that Olmert wanted to give back to Assad the Golan Heights. And he started negotiations, some of you might remember. He started negotiations with Assad to give him the Golan Heights so that the Syrian border would come almost up to the Kinneret. And what would he get in return, ladies and gentlemen? He'd get guarantees from Syria. Now I ask you, look at Syria today, 10 years later. Syria is in shreds. Guarantees from Syria would be completely meaningless. Assad has killed hundreds of thousands of his own people. That part of South Lebanon and the Golan is a complete Hezbollah stronghold. The ISIS and the battle, Syria has become a battlefront. Imagine we would have given back the Golan under Olmert. It would have been a fatal mistake. HaKadosh Baruch Hu saved us time and time again. Unfortunately, misguided leaders have suggested Barak wanted to give away enormous amount of land. Olmert wanted to give away a lot of land. Each time HaKadosh Baruch Hu saved us by them saying no. They said no. And with that, we are here still today, and Baruch Hashem, Israel is in a strong position, and I now have to wrap up, but I'll get a chance afterwards, please God, to say a few more words. I've given you a little bit of a taste of some of the thinking, why indeed, strategically, politically, biblically, the idea of a two-state solution is an insane solution. Handing over to people who are dedicated to our annihilation, to giving them strategic advantages and encouragement. And for that reason, I'm against the motion. Thank you very much.
As the person then proposing the insane solution, I'll have to tell you that we're going to go for a little ride together. And we're going to ride a little bit through history, and we're going to ride a little bit through geography. And we may even touch rabbinics, because I think the rabbinics of it does actually form the basis for what we're doing. I stand for practical Zionism. I stand in the event that the Palestinians want to make peace, not for biblical promise, and not for messianic expectation. You may have seen those words somewhere before. Between the Mediterranean and the Jordan, there are 12 million people, 6 million Jews and 6 million Arabs. If you don't make a decision, if you go for drift, you have made a decision and you will have a binational solution. That is the problem. problem is, how do we deal with this? Do we want a binational solution? I certainly didn't go to Israel for that. The grand strategy of Israel and of the Jewish people in the last couple of hundred years has been to stand self-responsibility, self-respect, self-confidence, build a state, compromise, take an army, create diplomacy, organize your state. Well, we've got a little touch of corruption sort of flaking around there. But build and take compromises. If only we'd had the chance to do that in the 30s or 40s, it would have been wonderful. I don't have to explain that to you. But we have abandoned quietism and pietism, and we have taken responsibility for what we want to do. The question is, what do we want to do? That's the question here today. I really rather like President Trump's formulation. Two states, one state, whatever you two guys want. Well, that's great. If we can, peace is made by two sides simultaneously. War is one side. One side makes war. Two sides make peace. What do we want? What do the Palestinians want? Very hard to identify these together. The Palestinians, it seems, will often miss an opportunity, but I think they want to be rid of Zionism. I don't think they want checkpoints. I think they want their own education. I think they want their own polity. It's very weak now. I'm not suggesting for a moment that one could make peace with the current Palestinian polity. The Jews, however, haven't quite decided, as you can see, where their boundaries should be. And this is really a question of the self-identification of the Jewish people. What do we want? Do we want X? Or would we like perhaps to try and live in peace with our neighbors in accordance with some of the Jewish ideals rabbinically stressed? Now, the statecraft of the Jewish people up till now has been, as I said, to compromise. And these, even though it's been giving tangibles for intangibles, we give land, they give ideology of peace. And it's been hugely successful. It's been done so far, compromise in 48, held by the army, okay? 6,000 people died, but it worked. The next example, the next time we ever gave back territory, except when we were forced back by the United States in 56, is after the peace treaty with Egypt in 1979. Clearly one of the most successful peace treaties in the history of the world. It's lasted for 40 years in extremely volatile circumstances. It's been through two Lebanese wars and endless Gaza wars. There's no Southern Command that exists anymore. There's hardly any. There are no tank armies threatening Israel. The eating up of a third of the economy of the state of Israel to face the Egyptian army is gone. We have a friendly or semi-friendly country there that has kept its word. And think of the boost and the boon that has been to the economy. It's the way which led forward. It has also, of course, held during the period that we must call the Iranian Empire. We are now in the Iranian Empire. They are extremists, martyrs, Shiites, they kill themselves, anything you want. But they have a huge influence on the Palestinians, and they've driven the Palestinians in the wrong direction. Now, the other treaty which has worked and forms the other bulwark of our position is the treaty with Jordan. Treaty with Jordan, very long boundary, totally quiescent, totally quiet. Nobody infiltrates from that. You may remember people were infiltrating from that. Jordan is, in fact, a friendly country. I go so far as to say that the eastern boundary of the state of Israel is more or less towards Iraq, if you think strategically about these things. Okay? So these two treaties are the model, and these two treaties have worked. And they have prevented something which I have not yet mentioned to you, but I will be mentioning all the time. The large amount of deaths that it took of Israeli soldiers and Israeli civilians to keep Egypt out of Israel. That was a fantastic, there was every decade there was a war after from 48, 67, 48, 56, 67, 73. I don't have to tell you the numbers, we're talking about hundreds and hundreds of soldiers who had to die to keep that frontier safe. It's now safe. It's held for 40 years. It's unbelievable. Oslo is a different story. Oslo is the first attempt to make a peaceful settlement with the Palestinians. It's still the governing treaty, by the way. No, that's the reason why it gives us the agreement we can actually stay there till it's finally settled. It didn't work at all, really. It did, however, again, boost the Israeli economy. It gave us a large number of other countries that joined diplomatic relations with us until it was traduced by Arafat, until he stuck his knife in and we had the second intifada. All right? So Oslo is, you can look at it whether it's half full or half empty. The people of Palestine have to live somewhere. You can't make a peace treaty with them and humiliate them, or it won't hold. Like the peace treaty with the Germans in Versailles after the First World War. And there are thousands of other examples. You can't make a rotten compromise with them like Munich. It's useless. You have to catch them when they want to make peace, and you have to hold them to that peace when they've made it. And we won't be able to go into the technical story about how you make peace. That might come the actual physical across the green table, which is what I spent my career doing. But there you are. The benefit of peace, I hope you'll understand, is not just economic. It's in lives saved for all of us. We all know people. We all know everybody in Israel. We all know people who died or killed or whatever. That's what we're talking about. Okay? That's what it's all about. And to say that the threat is continuing is true, but you have to hold it. How can you hold it? There are various safeguards. You may demilitarize, as we were intending to do with Syria, until the president of Syria decided his bets are better placed elsewhere. What a stupid decision. He could have been ruling in Damascus, his family in Damascus, and milking Lebanon, l'ol envoy, with the blessing of the United States, because they'd have been behind a peace treaty with Syria. They just messed up completely. They weren't interested. Okay? But you have the possibility of demilitarizing. You have the possibility of sanctions, re-entry. If the thing fails, you have the possibility of an international force. The one in Sinai works. Other ones with the UN, what we have to call the devil's playground in the UN, don't work and won't work. An international force with the EU, of course, is useless. You have the United States backing any future peace agreement we might have with the Palestinians should they come forward, which means pouring in a vast amount of United States American money, which the Americans have been doing to back up the treaty between Egypt and Israel since it began. We get $3 billion a year, they get $2 billion a year. You all know how much money England got after during the Second World War and how much money Europe got after the Second World War. We haven't yet quite made that amount of money from the United States. Okay, and hopefully the peace can be held. But if the Palestinians do want a peace, I don't think we should be the ones to reject it. If they come round, now what is a real peace? Let's talk for a second about the possibilities. How long have we got?
At least 5 minutes.
A thousand years. What is the possibility of where are we? All want real peace. The majority of Jews in Israel, I think, want separation, without a doubt. There's still a national consensus for a two-state solution. The problem is not, of course, what you want to do, separate. We've separated from the Egyptians. It's how you get to go, how you get to separate. And as has been said already, there are dangers, there are risks. The question is when the risk becomes viable. And here, rabbinically speaking, you have to look to the military and political leadership. To the mumche, the expert, has a very strong role in that. Of course, there is a danger. There is the high ground overlooking Lod. There are lots and lots, but rockets come in all directions now. Hezbollah can shoot rockets on Lod, as they already have done from Lebanon, even though we withdrew from Lebanon. That's a separate war, which will play itself out in a different way. I don't think the Europeans have the faintest understanding of what it's like to live under the threat of rockets. They sort of see terrorists as moderate militants. That's about as much as you can get. And you saw that again in Westminster, by the way, with certain people playing that system. How do you get to, and the current international system is not really strong enough to do this. So we will be by ourselves. Everybody knows what we want. Nobody wants to be a sucker and do it until the Palestinians are ready. If the Palestinians are ready, how on earth can we turn them down? I find that unbelievable. Unbelievable. We're not a religion of xenophobia. We're a religion of Jewish ideals. We're a religion that believes in Kiddush Hashem. We are a religion that understands the value of taking in the what the nations believe. And if you don't do that, you'll be excoriated like you were in Lebanon, or forced out like you were in Sinai. We have to compromise, they have to compromise. Will they compromise? I can't say yet. What would the compromise be? Something like, of course, settlement blocks. Some people will have to move. We move people to get out of Sinai. We move people to get out of Gaza. We might have a chance to talk a little bit at length, a little bit more about the disengagement. That's an extremely important limud you have to get through, because the disengagement saved lives. You have to say land or lives. You have to think about that. 18 soldiers died in the year before the disengagement, guarding the settlements and the roads to them. What's that for? They're not dying anymore for that. In the previous year, unfortunately, exactly the same number died. I got the figures for 2 years. I managed to dig them out. 38 soldiers in the 2 years before the disengagement. Land or life? Where are you? Where are we? We want to be an oral agoyim. Do we not want to give light unto the nations? How can you do that if you're oppressing the Palestinians? Now, I'm all for holding onto the Palestinians and oppressing them as much as you can while you have to sit on them. And there are many other countries that have had to do that. If they come forward, are we going to turn them down? I don't believe it. I don't believe we can. I don't for a moment believe that the people in Israel would turn them down. I think they'd turn out any government that turned down a serious offer. How long? 2 minutes. It's like it's going on forever. We've got so much time. The Palestinians will come to a compromise. They're a much weaker polity than we are. You saw that in the Second Intifada once Sharon decided to go in. They're finished. They were killing like vast numbers of people of us, but in the end, We could crush them. They couldn't stand it. We can stand it. Okay. I haven't got time to tell a story. But I will say answer one of the questions. I will say this: you here have to make up your mind, land or life. It's not land for peace. It's land or life. If you and all Rabbanim that I can think of in the mainstream Orthodox tradition, Ovadia Yosef, Chief Rabbi Dubovitz, of course, Liechtenstein, Soloveitchik, they all believe exactly the same thing. Pikuach Nefesh is suspends every other rule. But even if we didn't have that, 25,000 people, that's the number of people who died in the wars in Israel, plus another 4,000 in the terror. 25,000 people died for what? To defend the state? To defend the people, or to extend its boundaries? Land or life? Thank you.
Thank you very much. The rabbi now has a strict 5 minutes to respond. And if I can have a chairman's prerogative, a quick question. Within the response, could you say what this one state looks like? That's your prerogative.
The question of what a one-state solution could look like is a long subject. There are many different suggestions to possibly make that work. Lots of the politicians in Israel have mapped out lots of different possible suggestions, but that wasn't the motion this evening. The motion this evening wasn't what solution is going to work. The motion this evening was, is a two-state solution a viable solution? And my position is that it's insanity. And that the way you have presented it, land or life, is actually a completely misunderstanding of the dynamics of what is happening in Israel today with our enemies. There is actually the only possible sign that we have that they want peace at all. Because you mentioned several times, if they're ready, how can we turn them down? The only possible way that anybody can think they're ready is because they're saying occasionally that they're ready. But that is clearly, totally, only a deceptive, strategic lip service to wanting to say we're ready in order to gain more strategic advantage. If you look at Oslo carefully, you will see that they extracted from Israel a tremendous advantages. First of all, the PLO, which everybody agreed was a terror organization, was sanitized and repackaged, a bit like sort of a financial repackaging of completely toxic debt. They repackaged the PLO to be the PA, suddenly the Palestinian Authority. It was exactly the same people with exactly the same charter, and the charter, part of the deal was they're going to change the charter and delete from the charter that their goal was to eliminate Israel completely, but they never did it. They never changed their charter. They remain to this day with the charter that their goal in life is to destroy and annihilate Israel, and Hamas, for good measure, adds not just Israel, but Jews anywhere. So we're dealing with the most fanatical Jew haters on planet Earth and the most successful Jew haters on planet Earth, because they are managing to deceive Jewish leadership into thinking, oh yes, we'd like some peace, give us advantages. As soon as we gave them armaments under Oslo, the armaments were used against us, the centers of autonomy that were given over in Yehuda and Shomron became hotbeds of terrorism. And we suffered hundreds and hundreds of deaths through the Intifada, right? Which was only created because we stupidly, believed when they said we want peace, they didn't want peace any more than Hamas wanted peace when they said, yes, vacate Gush Katif and you'll get peace in return. What did we get in return? We got a Hamas state which terrorizes their own people, executes their own opponents, no human rights, and a completely disaster for the Palestinians themselves. It's a disaster. Quite a number of polls have shown that many Palestinians themselves in Yehuda and Shomron, the last thing they want to do is live under a Palestinian state, because living under an Israeli state gives them much more opportunity, much more freedom, and much more human rights. So I think the whole idea that in fact our enemies want peace is a complete delusion. They don't want peace. They're not interested in peace. They're interested in getting deeper and deeper into a position of strength to be able to eliminate Israel completely. And you know who says that? They say it themselves. When they talk to each other, if you look at their charters, they're interested only in one thing, and that is the destruction of the Jewish people, the destruction of Israel. Any advantage that we give them, any state that we give them, will only be used as a platform for intensifying their hatred and destruction of Israel. And there's not the slightest indication that they've turned a corner on that. Let me just say what would be an indication. What would be an indication would be if they changed the textbooks in their schools. If after Oslo, they would have changed the textbooks in the schools and stopped educating to hatred and murder and massacre and hostility, if they would have changed those textbooks and said, right, we're going to bring up the next generation to look for peaceful solutions, then I would have said, oh, maybe they mean it really. But here they were telling us they want peace, and then they're going home and rolling on the floor in laughter that we believed. And tomorrow they get up and teach their children that what we really want to do is spill as much Jewish blood as possible. We celebrate every possible tragedy to the Jewish people. We make a yontif out of it. We fund the families of anybody who kills himself in the service of this cause. And unashamedly, make out of this their greatest achievement in life. The more Jews they can kill, the happier they are. To suggest that these are people that we could believe, let's say we'd sit down and negotiate, and in the end, what would they give us? A piece of paper with their name on it, and they've signed it. What is that? What can that possibly be worth? Then the next morning, they're pursuing an educational policy based on the genocide of the Jewish people. Thank you very much.
I said at the beginning that there would be a little bit of rabbinical learning, and it was on display there, and I was reminded of the terms of the debate, and the rabbi is quite correct. He has dealt with the terms of the debate.
I'm less interested in the terms of the debate. I'm much more interested in putting the argument in the terms that I feel it exists. So you won't be surprised if I feel that people can actually change. We don't hate the Germans. We are sorry, we used to hate the Germans. We certainly don't hate the Palestinians, but nobody can say the Germans haven't changed. I'm postulating a possibility that they will change, might change, have some of them certainly have changed, because I've spoken to them. Some of them have certainly changed, and some of them have not. The Hamas, I couldn't agree with you more, is an anti-Semitic organization which more or less models itself on the worst possible, and they're terrible for their people, and I don't really think they're going to be there forever. They are appalling. But in other Palestinians, we might have a possible solution. I don't know, but I'm not going to say that we can reject it. Nobody is saying that the risk is not dangerous. The Israeli army is not going anywhere. Even after the peace treaty and a two-state solution with the Palestinians, the Israeli army is not going anywhere. We'll all be drafted till the end of time. I must just, however, say that even before Oslo, people were being killed in this war. And the idea that we should never take a risk for peace is an idea that I find anathema. We have to take a risk for peace. We have to. We're not that big a nation, after all. We have to still balance peace. It's absolutely no surprise to me, though it seems to be a surprise to some of you, that the former heads of the security services are the very people who say that we need to make peace to save the state. You will remember that movie. And last week, the outgoing head of the Mossad said exactly the same thing. I quoted from him at the beginning, 12 million, six and six, you have to decide if you what you want to do. We occupy 2 million of them. I don't really believe we occupy Gaza in a very effective way. And there's 2 million in Israel. Lieberman, our defense minister, thinks you can move the 2 million in Israel. In other words, the boundaries would fluctuate near towards Haifa as well. I'm not sure about any of that. I've studied these boundaries in very, very great detail. They're a mess. There's certainly no way in which there can be any kind of security boundary. There's no River Rhine. There are no mountains that separate us. The security is from the army. The security is not from you build a wall, it's from how you garrison the wall, as you've got in Hadrian's wall and as you've got in our wall. Security is the morale of the people, and you forget. We cannot lose half of our people who are disgusted by the continuous need to sit on the Palestinians. Everybody does it, everybody goes to the army, but nobody enjoys, very few people enjoy doing this. We want to reunify ourselves, we want the moral advantage back to us, we want to gain the moral strength out of unity. That's a lot more important than where we are going to live. And as Rabbi Lichtenstein said, the head of the yeshiva in Har Etzion, well, if we have to give back, and I don't think there's the slightest danger of having to give back Gush Etzion, it was Jewish before 48, but if we have to give back, we'll just move the yeshiva. These things have to be taken into account. We're not there for individual people, we're there to secure the whole nation within a territory. That is what I think we have to do. Security and stability, life, not land.
Saying in journalism, when we're asking politicians questions, that sometimes the question is more important than the answer. That's because they don't answer, not because. But I would like to give the honour of the first question to the ambassador, because I think that the question itself will be very worth listening to, as of course will the answers. All questions are worth listening to. But this one comes with several decades of experience behind it. Ambassador.
Thank you very much. And I think you kindly agreed I could say a few remarks just before the questions, which is really very kind. And I should say, too, that I'm not speaking in any official capacity tonight. I'm no longer a member of Her Majesty's Diplomatic Service. I wasn't sure whether to come tonight, but I've known David for a long time, partly because I'm tired of these debates. We've been having them for as long as I can remember. I've had 30 years involvement now in Israel one way or another, and this debate has been ongoing, and I think a certain amount of despair is in order about why it never gets anywhere. I'm also very cautious because, speaking as a Brit and a European, I'm not sure it's for us to push solutions out there to the region. We haven't done a fantastic job in the past. There's some pretty complex history. And I accept that Europe in deep, deep history has failed in relation to the Jews. That's a huge human tragedy. But there are historical links between my country and Israel. You mentioned the Balfour Declaration. And of course, I have lived it out there, both in Israel and in Saudi Arabia and other parts of the region. I do know why it's very hard for Israel to trust anyone, actually, and to feel that it's got to make complex compromises on its biblical homeland, as the rabbi has said. And I've obviously met and talked to, I think, almost all sectors of Israeli opinion when I'm out there. I've also, of course, talked to Palestinians. Sorry about the microphone. And I just don't believe that they're all dedicated to Israel's destruction. There are, of course, some real hard guys out there who are a problem. But I wish you could have been with me in Rabbi in Ramallah last May when I was there talking to young Palestinians. And they shocked me. I mean, they basically said, we know the two-state solution is over. Look at that settlement up there. I'm tired of going through the checkpoints. I'm tired of having to go to Amman to fly out to the world. Rather, no one's going to do Ben-Gurion. Our fathers have failed. It was a worthwhile struggle. We would have liked to state. But can I not introduce them to some young Israelis and let's get on with the one-state solution? That was what they were saying. And they were just bored and frustrated with not being able to lead normal lives. And, you know, it's very hard not to sympathize with young people, 23, 24, when you realize the forces that can pull them in a negative direction unless something happens to meet their aspirations. I used to tell my team in Tel Aviv when I was out there, you know, you've got to understand politically and morally both the Israeli and the Palestinian side. It's very, very difficult, it's very, very demanding, and it will blow your brain. But you have a moral duty to try and do that, because you are dealing with two valid nationalisms. Now, of course, many Israelis will say Palestinian nationalism is a fake construct, and I think there is a degree to which some aspects of Palestinian identity were created in reaction to Zionism, but the reality is at the moment you have two valid nationalisms out there. And the question for me is, in that complex situation, what is it that gives Israel the security it deserves? I think that's the thing we all agree on. How do you get to that outcome? And certainly what I want. Now, my own view is that a two-state solution would have been right. It was the only way to give valid expression to the two valid nationalisms out there. But I think it's no longer possible. The moment has passed. You go around the territories these days. The settlements are incredible. I mean, it's not just a question if you were to move them. It's the whole infrastructure that goes with them. I think to get to a valid two-state solution, you've got to move between 70,000 and 150,000 Jewish settlers from the West Bank. I don't think any Israeli government could do that and survive. I think, actually, it's failed, the two-state solution, unfortunately. Unless there's a miracle, and miracles do happen in that part of the world. I certainly think one of the aspects that hasn't come through tonight is the regional solution. I mean, there was a Saudi peace plan, the Arab Peace Initiative from the early part of this century, and I believe, from my contacts with the Saudis, that they are prepared to reshape that in really interesting ways. They want to deal with Israel. They have a common enemy in Iran. They have a common mistrust of a lot of people. But they can't move without a deal on the Palestinian issue. That is the basic price for that. But I do think that what's happened in the region now has simplified what the demand is on Israel in relation to the Arab Peace Initiative. But my worry is that a two-state solution is no longer possible, and we are essentially living with conflict till the cows come home, until something really nasty happens that wakes the international community up to what you're going to do about it. You duck the question about what other solutions there might be, as it were. But I believe, and there are models out there, confederal, federals, what's it. But for me, they all fail on the critical issue of who controls what on the ground. No other solution apart from a two-state solution begins to get to that. So I have two questions. I mean, I don't want to say what is the alternative to the two-state solution, but a question that I wait to arrive at you is that what happens to the Jewish state and the values of the Jewish state if you are a long-term occupying power? How do you cope with that contradiction at the heart of the very noble Zionist and Judaism idea? And to David, do you think the regional, what's now on offer from the region, does offer something that could energize the political debate in Israel and create new approaches to a two-state solution? Thank you very much indeed for taking it.
you feel that the two-state solution is off the table to a certain extent. I find that quite...
not making UK policy.
I find that quite encouraging. I think you're right. I think they're right. I certainly, with the new United States ambassador to Israel, David Friedman, I think he'd probably agree with you that that's not the direction that he'll be going in, or that the new American administration will be going in a two-state solution. But I certainly am encouraged to hear that. The young people you spoke to in Ramallah, I think if they woke up tomorrow and they were living in a Palestinian state, they'd get a real nasty shock. I think that they'd find that their human rights, especially the girls, would find that their lives were disastrous, and that their economy was disastrous, and that their opportunities were disastrous, and their educational opportunities were terrible. And I think that they want to live under Israeli rule because they live a much better life under Israeli rule than they would under a Palestinian state. So in actual fact, I think we are caring for them. There's no question that the sanitation and the education and everything about the quality of life in Yehuda and Shomron is only what it is today, positively, because of Israel. If it would have been a Palestinian state, it would look like Gaza. And that would certainly be a disaster for the residents. What would be a possible solution? This is a much longer and complex subject, but certainly it would go somewhere along the lines of, Yehuda and Shomron is divided up into A, B, and C areas, and most of the Israeli, I don't use the word settlement, it's also one of those words which is not, which is a sort of a word which concedes the argument before you start. They're not settlements, they're neighborhoods, they're villages, they're cities, the Israeli cities in Yehuda and Shomron. If you go to Gush Etzion and you go to Ariel and you go to the big centers in Yehuda and Shomron, these are cities, they're not settlements, I promise you. The people living there are residents and citizens of Israel, just like the people in Tel Aviv, and they're not settlers at all. The word settlers and settlements always gives the intention of impermanence and sort of a temporary, we're just here for a while. This is absolutely not the case. They're there to stay, and they will certainly be there to stay. And I think you're right, no Israeli government could move them and survive. That's absolutely the case. But certainly, most of these cities in Yehuda and Shomron are in Area C. And I think at some point, Israel will probably have to, in some way or another, annex Area C. And areas A and B will be given autonomy, demilitarized autonomy, for the Palestinians to live in under Israeli rule, but with their own autonomy. Something along those lines is being discussed in the Knesset. That's called the Naftali Bennett plan. There are variations on this theme, but certainly that's the type of solution which is being discussed. And it's being done in a way to give the Palestinian residents the best possible quality of life, but to deny them sovereignty, because sovereignty for them means the destruction of Israel.
Thank you. And way ahead, there's lots of questions, which we're coming to in a moment, but you have the one for me.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you, Tom. I can't just leave that on the table without saying that I didn't hear an answer to what is supposed to happen for the continuation of the current mess. I did not hear it. And we need to hear it. And there isn't an answer. Because if you annex, you give them a vote. If they got the vote, that's 6 million versus 6 million. And Ahmed Tibi is Prime Minister. Where did the Zionist experiment go? It's ridiculous. It's unacceptable. I don't think it's acceptable. The word insane has been bandied around. That's close to it. Now, I was asked, and I'm not for a minute suggesting that when we need to occupy, we don't occupy with the full force. And I'm not for a moment suggesting there aren't 1,000 problems about the high ground overlooking Lod, which I believe actually is the most sacred spot in Israel, because that's where all the Jews can actually enter, which of course they couldn't in the past. So I believe that Lod is by far the most sacred spot in the country. Now, I was asked about the possibility of launching The launch question in launching it through, we were using the regional ideas that the Arabs have suggested. The launch question is always interesting because it's always something that launches the talks, like the invasion of Kuwait led to the idea that we have to have, the Americans had to have an army put together. They had to put together an army. To do that with Arabs, they need to invade Iraq. They needed to agree, we'll launch the talks. They launched the talks in Madrid, very interesting, and Washington, very interesting, I was part of all that, and we got the peace treaty with Jordan out of it. It's not nothing. The launch question is always interesting, but it's extremely technical. It's very technical to see if that is the thing which will let the two sides come together to want to talk at the same time. Once they're sitting in the same room, then it's a different world. The launch sort of is like a rocket. The launch kind of falls away, and you move on to the next step. So I don't really care what launches it. Trump might even launch it. God knows what he's going to do. He could turn on a dime. We've no idea how he's going to behave at all. I don't believe he's got any idea, really, how he's going to behave at all. The Arabs, but you can see, the idea of the Arab regional, which has been around for quite a while, it means that there is, I agree with Prime Minister Netanyahu, it means that there is some motion there, brought on perhaps by Iranian fears of Iran.
Right, way ahead now. Short, snappy questions, short, snappy answers, and the first one goes to the woman in the second row there. The microphone on its way to you. Yep, go ahead.
It's not working, the microphone's not working.
I can speak very loudly.
You spoke of Egypt and Jordan.
Sorry, who is the question to?
David. You spoke of Egypt and Jordan. These are two sovereign states. The problem in Yordan Shamron is not the same at all. It is not the same type of sovereign border. You are talking, you yourself live in Jerusalem, and you yourself know that if you wish to go to Tel Aviv on the 413, you go in and out of Palestine. This is not the same as having a border with Egypt or Jordan, and it is not the same as having talks in Washington or Madrid or wherever you like. You referred very briefly to Avigdor Lieberman, the defense minister, and as you probably know better than I, his solution is to move the people, not the land. Have you considered this?
Brief answer from David, and then we'll go around the room.
Well, peak population movement is very difficult. The Greeks and the Turks did it with enmity which remained in 1920s, which remains to this day. There was a vast movement of people, of course, after the Second World War, when we left Europe, what was left of us, and the Germans were pushed back into Germany. These are very, the Palestinians are in our, let me say, French tree, in our kishkas, right? It's not going to be difficult. It doesn't mean that it's not doable, and I think it's something that if it comes to it, if there is, as I say, some decency on the other side, if they recognize that we're there to stay, that's really the point, isn't it? If they recognize that we're there to stay, we can't say to them goodbye, we're not going to sit and make a peace treaty with you.
Look in the second one to the back.
Shalom, I'm from Israel, and my parents were refugees from the Middle East. And the main problem is with the definition, what is two states? What you mean, Ambassador, is that one state will be Judenrein without Jews, and the other state will be Jews with Arabs.
Who is your question to?
And all the solutions, all the peace that worked with Egypt, is there is no Jews in Egypt, and the only Jews in Sinai were kicked out of Sinai. And every Arab country, they kicked out the Jews. It's Judenrein in all the Middle East, only in Israel, and the same in Jordan.
What is the question?
The question is, this is not two states for two nations. This is one state for only Palestinians, Judenrein, without Jews, and the other state will be Jews and Arabs. Again, the Israeli Arabs, we have 20% of the population. So that's not the solution. It's not two states for two people. It's no state for the Jews, again.
If I could paraphrase into a question then.
Thank you.
I think that's coming to me. Yes, one often plays with our Arab opponents and says, well, what's the address of the biggest shul in Saudi Arabia? Where is it? And you get sort of this glum kind of. It's a mess. Of course it's a mess. But your family left somewhere in the Middle East and came to Israel. The whole movement in the last 20th century, throughout the whole of the Middle East, was to identify and create separate nationalisms. It's not just the Jews who were thrown out of Arab countries, all the Greeks were thrown out of Arab countries, not speaking of the British. Everybody was, there's been a kind of a reorganization, international units. I'm not actually in favor of nationalism as such, but there's no international system that I will agree to which leaves a state for every other country and not for the Jews. So we have to have a state, the Jews have to have a state, it more or less has to be with the idea that the Palestinians ought to have a state too if they're willing to share the responsibilities and take responsibilities for themselves.
We've got about 10 minutes left, so let's keep this speed up. Gentlemen, I was going to say there's a gentleman with a kippah there.
Very pleased that Rabbi Kimche does speak here as a leader of near Israel. I have been brought up to respect the rabbis wherever his views are, and I'm going to be. There is no possibility of two states for one simple reason, because there is not, in my knowledge, any kosher Gruyere. And if you look at the geography of all the positions of whatever you call it, settlements and so on, they're impossible for them to make a state.
What is the question, please?
That's, the state is how many Palestinian entities are, and where would you resettle them? You can't resettle 70 or 80,000 Jews. Where are you going to put them without fight?
Yes, that's a clear question. Thank you. Where are you going to put the Palestinians? Okay. Sorry, is that a fair summation of your question? Where are you? Yes.
Let me just say a couple of big picture answers, because to go into the details here, I'm not going to be able to in a few minutes. But let me just say one big picture issue. One big picture issue is, in many situations in life, there are no solutions, immediate solutions. People have, also in their own personal lives, situations where to speak of a solution is ridiculous. Chas v'shalom, somebody is born with a defect, or a genetic defect, or disabled. When there are no solutions to this, you have to cope with it. You have to find ways to manage it, and to cope with it, and to make the best possible life in difficult circumstances. You can't believe that every situation has a solution. Talk of solution in situations when you're dealing with people who want completely to destroy another nation and demand every inch of the land on which they're living in order to be happy, that is not something to which there is, even in theory, a solution. And I'd like to zoom out a little bit, just for a moment.
Briefly.
I'd like to just briefly zoom out a little bit, just for a moment, and say that the greatest threat to world civilization is the Islamist aspirations of world domination through violence, and every single person in this room would be beheaded if they could in order to achieve their goal. And what's happening in Israel is a microcosm. What's happening in Israel is a microcosm, of what's happening to civilization. We offer what happened in England a few days ago in Westminster Palace was a little tiny sliver,
Rabbi,
of what's happening in Israel all the time, motivated by the same ideology.
I've been rough on the questioners, so let me be rough on you. What are you going to do with the Palestinians? I know you said there isn't necessarily a solution, but you're going to have to, just because that was the question.
We're going to find autonomous cities and autonomous areas where they can live with autonomy, without any nationalist power, because nationalist power for them means only one thing, the elimination of Jews and Israel.
Thank you. Gentlemen there, we've already got three over here. If we have any dispensation to go over, I'm sure anybody that wants to leave around about the 20 past mark, we wouldn't be put out, but if anyone's happy to stay for a couple of extra minutes, we can take a couple of extra questions. Yes, sir.
Ambassador Kornbluth has actually said that it's not possible for Jews to live with the Arabs, they would have to be moved out. Why can't the reverse be said, where the Arabs are actually moved out to eastern Palestine, which is now Jordan, and it's been said that...
I don't know why I was expecting that question, but I, in negotiating with the Jordanians, met both the Crown Prince Hassan, who was sitting opposite us, and King Hussein of Jordan. You have to see these people to believe how good they have been in keeping their word. We, the Jordanians, please, we can't... expect to sort of change their whole population makeup, which is anyway 60% Palestinian, by asking more Palestinians to go and live there. That wouldn't work for us. That would destabilize the country, the very country that we're making peace with. You can't. I wouldn't want it. I wouldn't want their country to be unstable. It doesn't make the slightest bit of sense strategically at all. I'm a very, very big fan of the Jordanian monarchy. King Hussein took a risk for peace. He'd already seen Sadat go. So this man is a hero in my terms. Thank you.
Gentleman over there with the mic.
I've got a question for each one of you. So, Rabbi.
In that case, the answers have to be doubly brief.
Yeah, questions have to be very brief. Rabbi, you talk a lot about insanity. If you could wind the clock back to 79, would you be saying that Joshua should not give the Sinai back to Egypt? And that was insanity. Is that still your view?
Yes or no, it's fine on that.
Yes.
Okay.
That will also attack.
Okay. And David, that's one for you. You talked about that if the Palestinians were to show that they want peace, then we should reach out to them. What is your acid test in determining whether they genuinely want peace?
My acid test is quite clear. If they come to the acceptance of the Jewish people in the land of Israel, that's it. There's no more acid test. Peace means risk. Building the state means compromise.
Okay, we've got time for two more. There's one here and one here, and apologies to those who have put your hands up and haven't been able to.
Rabbi Kimche, you spoke about Lebanon, withdrawal from Lebanon, and a rocket base being set up there, and the same thing happening in Gaza. And the paymasters of both are Iran. So, question for David. Do you honestly think that the Ayatollahs in Iran are interested in any kind of peace for their proxies, including the Palestinians, Authority, or PLO, with the State of Israel, or the Jews?
Well, not having been to Iran myself, although my mum managed it, there's an argument, there's a strategic argument amongst the experts in Israel whether Iran would calm down if there was a peace with the Palestinians. There are even statements from Palestinian leaders, not from Iranian leaders, that they would. I tend not to believe it. But we can't not make peace with the Palestinians, because there's another enemy to deal with, because we've also got to think about Pakistan. We have to be able to unite ourselves and our strengths.
Right, the last question was chosen more or less at random, but I think you two know each other.
Vaguely, but I know a few of these people.
Yeah, well, I was hoping to end on a sort of high note.
This is going
to
be not
exactly. I just had a sense. Something came up with this sense.
Henry, we might have had a higher note.
No, I don't think it's going to get much higher than this, so I don't know what is going on between you in your intellectual hinterland, but please ask your question.
David, why are you less than honest when you talk about compromise? Because you should know that Israel behind the Green Line represents 16% of what was given and what is still extant in international law as San Remo, the Magna Carta of the Jewish people. And in fact, when Jordan was locked off Transjordan took Jordan illegally in 1921. That was supposed to be the sovereignty of the Arab people. And by the way, there are no two competing nationalities because 22 Arab states have been formed on land which is twice the size of the United States.
Which leads you to your question.
And the other question is, why? You must know that Shimon Peres, the archbishop in 1978, wrote a book, Tomorrow Is Now, in which he detailed in great detail what a disaster any Palestinian state would be on what was called the West Bank. Israel could not survive. There's room for one sovereignty only between the sea and the river and the sea, and it just is not viable to have more than one state.
The problem with Israeli politicians is they live forever. So Shimon Peres managed to change his mind about that, so that's question two. Question one, that was very interesting. That's exactly what happened with us when we were negotiating with the Syrians. The first stage is always called the exchange of curses, when you kind of establish the justice of your position and have to jump over that and ignore it. So there's not a lot I can really say, except to say the history is now irrelevant, Israel must compromise to survive, and it has compromised, and it has survived, and it's very strong. If the chance comes again, it must take it.
Why is this coming out?
Seriously, I mean, you know we could go on for another hour at least, and we've gone slightly over, but only slightly. I'd like to thank the questioners, because, as I said, you know, we say in journalism sometimes the questions are more important. It is very important that you ask them. Also, I hope we've had some progress, and the aim of the evening, I was told by the organisers, was to try and shed some light, but also to do it in the manner in which it's been done. You know, we're not going to go out and defriend each other, apparently. People under 40 might know what that means. So we've actually managed to conduct it in a very reasonable manner. And I'd like to thank both my colleagues here for the day.
So just to wrap up, I'd like to thank Rabbi Kimche and David Kornbluth, Ambassador David Kornbluth, and of course Tim Marshall for moderating, and our special guests, David and Anne Tom and Anne Phillips. I think we haven't quite come up with a solution yet, but we've got some time, and let's carry on talking. Thank you very much.